I greet you this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. I've entitled this sermon, The Open Door. It is based on the sixth of the seven letters to the churches in the book of Revelation, chapter 3 and verses 7 to 13. To the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut. And what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet, and acknowledge that I have loved you. Since you have kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come upon the whole world to test those who live on the earth. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have, so that no one will take your crown. Him who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will he leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. And I will also write on him my new name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Let us just for a few moments take a look at the more serious features of modern church life. In many parts of the world, especially in Africa and Europe, the church is facing a reduction in numbers, especially of younger people. There is a general shortage of candidates for the ministry. There is a general shrinkage in membership. The church seems to have less and less effect in the life of the world, even, especially in so-called Christian countries. There are new challenges facing the Church of Christ today as well. The COVID-19 pandemic, when many churches are still closed and others are only half open. Then again, other churches break the pandemic protocols and become centers of the rapid spread of the virus. And again, there are rotten apples where pastors rape, get involved in human trafficking, money laundering, not to mention getting their congregants to eat snakes and grass and spraying them with doom. And the unbelieving world looks on and says, look at the Christian church. Now, I'm not going to ask why. And I'm not going to blame either you or myself for this situation. Rather, in the light of the text from Scripture we have read, I want to put a challenge to you. I know all your ways, and look, I have set before you an open door. The difficult situation in which the church finds itself today. Is this not our opportunity? our open door leading to God knows what. But the challenge is to go through the door, to take the opportunity. When I was going to be a farmer, it was always my ambition to get an eroded, worn out, badly managed farm and build it up into something worthwhile, something with a challenge. I didn't want a farm that was already built up and running smoothly and just needed to be kept running. When I was called to the ministry, I remember having similar thoughts about the sort of congregation I'd like to go to. Something to build up with a challenge, with an open door to go through in faith. The book of Revelation describes John's vision of Christ in glory, reigning over his church. The seven letters were addressed to key churches and help us to appreciate the religious climate of his day. Here, in fact, is a grayish nucleus of a too human church. But isn't the church always like that? Certainly she has her magnificent moments when she carries all before her. But she also has her long stretches of time surrounded by hostility or by even more deadening apathy. She has her noble characters and her quite ordinary people. She has those on fire and those who are lukewarm. Often there is a confusion of honest effort to live up to her high calling alongside depressing failure. Yet it is this too human body of Christ which is God's instrument. The church at Philadelphia had little power and had but recently been founded, and her numbers were few. After commending her qualities, the risen Lord appeals to her to forget her weakness or immaturity and to look outwards. I have set before you an open door. History tells us that this feeble little church rose heroically to the challenge, grew in spiritual power, and for many centuries remained a bulwark of the faith. Today, the risen Lord, the head of the church, bids us look beyond our weakness and see, set before us, the open door. More often than not, this has been taken to refer to the mission of the church to remote nations. Now, we recognize this as the word of God for the local situation. The open door is just beyond the doorstep of our homes, our churches, our businesses. If we have any sort of imagination at all, everywhere we see the vision of the man of Macedonia, come over and help us. The world around us may not respond to our invitation to come to church, but it is hungry for help of every kind you can imagine. The door to human need, whether spiritual, social or material, is wide open to us. The world is calling for those who care, for those who are willing to go through the open door in the spirit of the upper room, bearing towel and basin, bringing salvation, healing, hope, reconciliation, but most of all, love. This sounds all very well, but I wonder whether we really and truly realize the implications. Beyond the open doors are unknown territories. We may be frightened by what we meet. We may be out of our depth. Certainly, quickly, we find that just the art of being kind is not all this sad world needs. More is demanded of us than just diffused neighborliness. Through the open door, we enter the human predicament in all its ramifications: poverty, filth, sin, greed, pride, selfishness, hatred, bitterness, misunderstanding, and apathy. The call to us is not to touch life widely at 1,000 points, but to enter deeply into human relationships. When we get below the obvious need of our neighbor, we discover him or her to be a victim of some form of human dilemma. Firstly, there is the meaninglessness of existence, which weighs heavily on many people. An atmosphere of uncertainty, insecurity, bewilderment, which results in their believing in nothing. Somehow, these folk have had everything reliable kicked from under their feet. Secondly, there is a sense of the insidious power of evil. People are appalled with the feeling of helplessness as they hear the documentaries of war, suicide bombers, and terrorism. People are horrified at the sudden outburst of violence, gender-based violence, and gang warfare in apparently peaceful neighborhoods. Shaken by the growth of crime, by the creeping drug trafficking, touching even their own young people. Thirdly, then too, people are confronted with the burden of human agony and suffering in a way that never before has been possible. The weekend newspapers, social media, the TV, the radio, and online streaming often tell us of the squalor in which some people live, in crates and old tanks, in our city centres. And I'm sure not a few of us thought, as we looked at those pictures, but for the grace of God, that could be me, or my wife, or my children. Yes, the doctors tell us that on an average, twice every week, some woman enters the surgery asking for the termination of pregnancy. And we hear that statistically, 2 in 3 marriages end in divorce. The lives of so many people seem to be without guidelines. Certainly, humans are proud of their scientific achievements, but sometimes they have disturbing thoughts, wondering if when we have conquered the earth, the world of steel and concrete will cease to be a place in which we want to live. No, my friends, with all our good intentions of neighborliness and desire to help, how often don't we feel we are only scratching at the surface? We feel so inadequate. I know I do, and I'm sure that many of you feel that too, that you are really only scratching at the surface. Before us lies an open door, a wonderful opportunity, a challenge to make God, the gospel, the church, meaningful and real for our children, our teenagers and young couples. But do you not sometimes feel hopelessly inadequate? What is the answer? There's only one answer, only one answer I know of. Standing in the open door of opportunity and human need as we do, and realizing our utter inadequacy, we must be driven back to him who on another occasion said, "I am the door." Men and women have discovered that Christ is the door into a new conception of life, into a vital relationship with God, a door leading into a God-filled universe, and so also into a new relationship with our fellow human beings, with our children, teenagers, young couples, a door into a world swept by evil and demonic powers. Through the door of Christ, we must pass before we enter the door of human need. Otherwise, we go empty-handed. The human predicament demands men and women who have realized the inadequacy, who are aware that their own hands are not clean and are driven with a renewed humility to lead others to Christ. There again we learn the language of forgiveness, the door open to a new beginning with God and with others, repentance, a complete change of attitude, reconciliation, being made at one with God and the total experience of life and with one another, especially those who are different from us. Grace, the love of God in action in every situation. Yes, even in the darkest spots of human tragedy, we can believe that in the human predicament, He is able to do immediately, immeasurably more than all we can ask or conceive. What do we learn? Where do we learn this except as we enter through the door of Christ? The doors of challenge and opportunity that face you and me, members of the church, or in any other aspect of life, can then be faced in quietness and in confidence. For therein, as the Isaiah the prophet puts it, lies our strength. And to conclude in the words of the Apostle Paul, we can go through that door of opportunity with faith, hope, and above all, love. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that during this COVID-19 pandemic, you have set before the church an open door, leading to new opportunities of sharing the good news in Christ through WhatsApp and YouTube. Help us, Lord, always to have the courage and tenacity to go through every door you set before us. Grant that as we go through the door that is Jesus Christ, your Son, we may, in faith, hope and love, venture towards new opportunities, new horizons, and exciting adventures as we follow Him wherever He may lead us. For His love's sake. Amen.
Father lives His golden lamp beside the open.
Go now in faith and trust to venture through every door that the Lord sets before you, and may his grace, peace and love be with you. Amen.